Okay, welcome and thank you for coming. You're going to experience about an hour, maybe a little more, of an extraordinary and unique class that I had the privilege of teaching. And in fact, I didn't do the teaching. They did. And what I mean by that, it was an experimental course here at Oglethorpe that I hope that we can encourage more professors to do. This was an interdisciplinary course at INT, a course in global problems and solutions. The goal of the course was not just to sit and theorize and think about and read, although that's very important, ideas about global problems, and there are many of them, but rather to select three or two, and my selection was not their selection. The class was run by the students. So there were no tests, there was no syllabus, there was none of the traditional things that you would think of in a class like we usually have here at any university. It was more built on the Oxford University method, and it was based on the idea that instead of me telling them what global issues they need to solve, they decided themselves. And because of that, they did an extraordinary job both locally and globally in solving the problems they're going to talk about in just a moment. So without further ado, I'm going to step away, as I did in the class. This class was also taught by conspirator here. Eli Arnold helped with the class, helped them do the research. They're going to tell you what they did. I think you'll find it very interesting. I'm going to let them introduce themselves first, and then it's all theirs. So we'll start with Desiree over here.
Hello, I'm Desiree Golden. My major is, I'm working on an individually planned major with focus in film.
I'm Aris Michelsen, and I'm a cultural anthropology major, also an IPM.
I am Celia Cortes, psychology major.
Hasan Syed, I'm an accounting major.
I'm Jalia Killings, I'm a dual degree environmental engineering major with a minor in public health.
And we'll start with the documentary, documenting the class.
Class began at 8:20 p.m. on January 9th, 2017 at Oglethorpe University. My expectations of the class were to gain a greater understanding of the global issues happening currently and use that knowledge to help me as an independent filmmaker, hopefully one day on assignment for National Geographic. Immediately, I was surprised by the different class model and the hands-on approach to learning, which coincidentally is how I learned the best. I was impressed.
I'm excited to introduce you an experimental model that we've been working on for quite some time in terms of how we'd like to see students more engaged in the classroom. And so that means that, surprise, there are no tests in class. No
it source. Seemed the rest of the class was as well.
Objectives, and you're going to decide what to do. We're going to be covering, if you know, from a high-level class, global issues, contemporary global issues, an interdisciplinary class in which you are going to be doing all the work, but you're going to produce a product, let's call it, something that you can actually tangibly use and work with your public. We're not going to just sit around and discuss theory, although I think that's important sometimes. So I put up here on the board, and you're going to make that decision. We can't possibly cover all these topics, as you know, in a period. So what I'd like you to do is get together as groups, or two groups, and decide which of these you would like to try to take on and find workable, meaningful, not pie-in-the-sky solutions to these truly difficult, complex global problems. I want to introduce my partner in good crime, which is Eli Arnold. He is the archivist here And my professor, this is Professor here at Oglethorpe, and he's going to talk a little bit about his role in helping you guys with modules.
Yeah, I'm really excited that I come to the library into this. As an Oglethorpe alum, I ended up coming to about 11 times in different classes here at Oglethorpe. All of his classes are amazing, but this is especially amazing. So my role, and the role of the library in this class, is going to be every Wednesday. You all are going to meet here in the library in reference comments. And if you meet online, or meet online that Wednesday, I'll log in to your, to your chat. So I'm embedding in this class for the full semester. So if you all have any research questions, any source evaluation questions, any copyright questions, even logistic things as well, if you all ever need something printed in color, or you need something printed on fancy paper, I can do that as well. So.
After the first couple of weeks, we as a collective deduced that the two most important contemporary global issues are the overall health of the planet and the equal rights for all of those living on it. By observing this fact, it became apparent that all other major issues facing our species fall under one of these two umbrella terms. We split into two groups, one focusing on climate change, the other focusing on human rights. Both groups established fairly quickly that we would produce some sort of awareness package or pamphlet to provide to incoming freshmen, as well as sharing the information with people throughout Atlanta and beyond.
How do you guys feel about this class so far? Are you enjoying, you thinking everyone's doing good?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's a great experiment, and it's just far better than I expected. Yeah, it's great.
And I thought, well, wow, why don't we just do, have a place at Oglethorpe that we can designate for, a place?
Yeah, that's true, because, they think about everything that is done in the area, and a lot of people don't know,
I saw, on this website, it was, they sell t-shirts, and two, fabrics are, a lot of things that, don't get recycled often, and so we could, recycle, fabric and then turn it into a t-shirt and sell it. And then I was also thinking we could do a book, a how-to book on how to move community and stuff, because everybody wants to be community on that they should be, because
I honestly really like your book idea to build off of that. I think we could have book or a little pamphlet or brochure, ebook of some sort, so we give to freshmen. And that would be impactful. We'd be think globally, act locally, like that. Or it's a pretty big idea, but we think that.
How do you
think we should
show up at
that?
Yeah. And then it could be five chapters or four or five chapters, I guess. Eco-friendly businesses, friendly restaurants, places that, make you work in gym or support you, or laundromat or anything, places eco-friendly. And then that's, I guess, that could be one side of it. Listed, obviously, places students can go to.
Yeah.
And then
the environmental group sought out businesses that advertise or identify as green in some way, with the purpose of adding them to their ebook titled Go You, which is a traveler's guide of sorts to support these local businesses taking a stand against climate change, as well as learning more information on how to personally reduce one's carbon footprint and make a difference in one's own backyard.
And it's a super tangible one. You can definitely do that in the time that we're allotted. Yeah, it seems really safe for me.
Yeah.
And freshmen coming to college for the first time, they're on their own, they're independent. It would be good to put decent habits in a knowledgeable environment early on. So I think it would be pretty impactful to give them, even to them, what it would say. So we should all do that.
Okay.
Who
started?
I've been thinking about what we're trying to do, how do we do something that's tangible that addresses human rights issue in a global way? And the Universal Declaration of Human Rights speaks to me and has for a long time. And I was sitting on the couch with my husband, and I began to annoy him about Gideon's Bible and how Gideon's Bible is in every hotel, motel drawer, like the top drawer. And I thought, there's so many people in this world who aren't Christian who may never open that. But what if it was the Universal Declaration of Human Rights? Not that I want to remove the Bible, but add the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And I just had that moment where, like, how did that happen? How could we make that happen? So I, now that's my like light bulb moment. Now we have to make it happen somehow, or at least try to.
So, well, the resources that got those Bibles to the hotels are huge.
Right.
So we
right.
have the resources that are
well.
But I have a friend that works in that area of law enforcement. Might be able to tell us what the high risk areas are in Atlanta. At the very least, it includes each individual hotel and
that
offer.
That could work for me. That could work. So, who I'd like to reach out to, I wrote an autobiography on her. It's Teresa Flores. She was the not so stereotypical case of trafficking. She was upper middle class and she was trafficked at night. So as a result, she had what is called SOAP, which is Save Adolescents from Prostitution. And so what they do is they have they give bars of soap to hotels and motels in areas at risk. And so it has a national human trafficking hotline. So I was going to reach out to them to see if they're doing it in Atlanta and specifically which hotels, and how could we, would it be possible for us to get bars of soap? Put them in at-risk areas, specifically like truck stops, gas stations,
yes,
on the highway.
Truck stops.
Because the highway is one of the biggest issues as to why human trafficking is prevalent in Atlanta, specifically because drugs smugglers know.
The human rights group put up flyers around campus and Atlanta in an attempt to expose the massive human trafficking problem engulfing our city and so many others, as well as hopefully actually helping people in trouble. Mass emails were sent to members of the United States Senate asking that the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights be added to all U.S.-issued passports to show that we as a nation believe and abide by the standards of equality described in the UDHR for all people of Earth.
Yes, but
you go to the bathroom, for sure.
We'll have to do some of that that positive disruption that Dr. Phelps is talking about, maybe post-it
even. So like some stations have the little clear glass ones that's not in place.
Yes.
So we do put there's some of the there to sleep there. So
what we're seeing is that they are self-directing, self-organizing, and self-correcting. So they really are capable of managing their own objectives and dealing with their concepts within their groups. So I'm sure that's what you see about the run. So.
All right, guys. Thank you for that feedback.
With the guidance of Dr. Collins and Professor Arnold, we began gathering the research regarding these issues as well as the necessary information that would help us formulate our abstract ideas into fully operating vessels of awareness. Of the two nights a week we met, one would be spent online discussing what we had learned and found out individually, as well as getting up to date on what the other groups were doing. This online platform also gave us the opportunity to continue individual research while simultaneously connecting via the web. The other night would be spent meeting in person to show tangible progress and hash out new plans and goals for the weeks ahead, as well as tackle issues or deadlines that are best handled in person. From that point forward, our time was spent divvied into our groups and working in the field, so to speak, as well as on our own. Our last few classes were spent in discussion of our participation in Oglethorpe's Liberal Arts and Sciences Symposium to be held on April 26th of this year. We also had the opportunity to have a meeting as a class with Dr. Shane Pruitt, Director of Student Engagement and Leadership, to discuss the best means of acquiring the funds to print several copies of the UDHR and Go You to hand out at the symposium alongside our presentation in April. In addition to answering all of our funding questions, Dr. Pruitt pointed the environmental group along the path that would lead to the achievement of their long-term goal of implementing e-bins on campus for the proper disposal of electronic waste. We closed with individuals sharing how they plan to have these projects outlive the duration of the 8-week class.
Three raised their hand, and it wasn't a small class, so I was shocked and disappointed. But of course, now everyone in the class does know what it is, and for those of you who don't, I've got the preamble here behind me. After experiencing the atrocities of World War II and living through that, Eleanor Roosevelt and a panel that she worked with closely came up with the preamble, and it was modified over time, the Declaration of Human Rights, and it has 31 articles, I believe. And what I love about it is that it protects everyone in the world, no matter where you are from, what you look like, who you are, what religion you practice or don't practice. And no article can violate the rights of another person's rights. So it doesn't matter, it just covers everyone and everything. And as Desiree filmed, when I thought about how many hotels and motels have Gideon's Bible and how could I make this happen, it turned out to be much more difficult in reality. And I think that a lot of people with great ideas experience that. And in the real world, we can't always accomplish what we set out to do, but we did try. I did speak to Shane Pruitt, and we tried to go through the official ways of applying for funds through Oglethorpe University, and unfortunately the funds weren't available, and due to copyright infringement, we couldn't actually print the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. But what I do have is an example and we had discussed making sure that we had the bilingual version because, as you know, everyone doesn't speak English. And my hope was to have it spread amongst the actual student body. I was trying to order 100 copies. I needed about $720 plus shipping and handling. And unfortunately, it was too close to the end of the year for any funds to be available for that dream. And then the hope was if we had gotten the funding and the booklets had arrived, then the student body would be invited to take a booklet and plant it somewhere in the world on their travels. And it would go out further, touch more people, and involve more of the student body. So through brainstorming with Shane Pruitt, I was able to take my idea from just trying to imagine myself trying to plant the Universal Declaration into individual hotel and motel rooms in hot spots in Atlanta, to involving more people in more places and hopefully spreading that idea throughout the world so that if someone was in a place where they could read it, that they might be able to fight for their own rights or someone else's, maybe ask for help if they needed it. And I hope that I can continue to pursue this goal. I still want this project to come to fruition. I still want to see it take place. It's kind of a reverse treasure hunt in a way to invite students to be able to place it somewhere out in the world, somewhere conspicuous where it will be noticed. In the meantime, during class, when we were trying to brainstorm and work out how to get the booklet, whether it already existed or not, because we didn't know for sure when we first started the plan if it existed in a multilingual version. But it was very easy to get in touch with the UN and the library there and the bookshop. And they pointed me in the right direction, showed me that the bilingual version did exist, or the multilingual version did exist. And then I went through the process of trying to garner the funds to do it. So in the meantime, I had other classmates working really hard to get something done immediately. So for example, PJ and I created a blanket form for our classmates to write to our senators. If you'll, next one. So there's a subcommittee on Western Hemisphere transnational crime, civilian security, democracy, human rights, and global women's issues. So while we were trying to come up with the funding and figure out how to make the disbursement of the booklet work, PJ and I wrote the blanket email and distributed it amongst the class and had them write to each senator on this list to try to petition our government to put the Declaration of Human Rights into every single U.S. passport. And by doing so, we hope that we can set an example to show that the United States is a leader, and if we could do it, certainly every other nation could include it in their passport as well. Because we believe that everyone should know about it. It should be recognized, honored, and that was one of the ways that we acted locally and immediately, regardless of whether we had the funds for the booklet or not. Thank you, PJ. If you'd like to.
Yes.
Yes.
Hey, everyone. I'm PJ. Going off of what Aris said, it was conveniently at the time which Ashton Kutcher spoke to the Senate about human trafficking and how it was a big issue. So, to be honest, I was not really aware of there being a Foreign Relations Committee, so I decided to look into it, and we found out there was a Human Rights Committee along with a few others. So that's what really encouraged us to reach out, because human trafficking was getting a lot more traction in the media and we thought it was a very timely issue.
Exactly. Thank you, PJ. So at one point, I don't know if you all are aware of it or not, but Atlanta was the number one hub for human trafficking in the United States. And it's now somewhere around fourth or fifth. And that didn't deter us, knowing that we'd slipped down was good news, but bad news because we're still in there. However, it does mean that the efforts that rights and that groups and organizations are doing are working. So it's good to know that what we do really does matter and people really do make a difference. So it's not all in vain, and I think that was really important for us. And then I'm gonna let Celia speak now because she acted under the human rights umbrella as well and was able to do something nationwide.
I'm really excited about it, Celia.
Awesome, thank you. So I'm Celia Cortes, and like many of you, I've had the great fortune of being able to travel the world. And with those travels, I have seen that people don't know what it is to have rights. I've been to countries where women are property, and men are killed for loving other men, and children are sold off into slavery, and little girls are married off to 70, 80-year-old men. So because of that, I decided to join the human rights group when it came to Dr. Collins' class. And we were working on some phenomenal things, but I knew that it was a long-term project. And because of what I do for a living, I have the opportunity to travel all over the country. And I thought about hosting something in a restroom or in a like a rest area of some sort. So fortunately, I have a friend all the way in Albania who's a graphic designer who was willing to contribute to our class and our project. And together, we put together this flyer. Everyone in the class voted on the photo, what we should use. And it includes the hotline. It includes some of the facts that someone who might be a victim of human trafficking would not necessarily know. So in seeing this, they'd see some of these things and think, oh, that's me. And there's a number for me. There's a phone number out there for me. So it is in English and in Spanish. I had the great fortune of being able to put it in the airport in Charlotte, Atlanta, Nashville, both Chicago airports, Phoenix, San Francisco, DC, thank you, Baltimore, Philadelphia. So, oh yes, thank you. So in putting them in the airports, we weren't sure if it was legal or not to put them in the airports. So I went in, like I had this whole incognito system going in there, double-sided tape to make sure that what we put up would not leave any marks behind so nobody could accuse us of vandalism. But we put them up in the restrooms. As I went back to all those airports, I would check. And for the most part, they were all still there. When I returned from my travels, PJ, Sandra, one of our other classmates, and myself, we hit up MARTA. And we rode from here down to the airport. We got off at every stop. We put them in almost every restroom. We put them on the MARTA train itself, in the vestibules. You heard me in the video that I'd say they smell like pee because they do. But that's a place where people sleep. People sleep there. And it had a great impact to the point that we even had law enforcement take down one of our flyers. He wasn't so busy that day. He was able to take down one of our posters. But all in all, we were able to post over 200 of them. And there are some in the back of the room. We didn't just do this for us as a class. We did this to spread a message. So my challenge to all of you is either take one of these with you or take a photo of it with your phone. We spend so much time on social media. All it takes is taking a picture of this and posting it on your page. Like, hey, I went to a symposium today and check out what I found. If we all post this and someone shares it and even one person's life is saved by calling this number, or one person is saved from years of misery by being able to call this number and get rescued, it makes a huge difference. And we all can have that impact. We unfortunately don't see it and don't feel it as much because we live in this environment. But I went and I was looking up news stories, and I was gonna print a bunch of news stories about sex trafficking, and then I realized I was gonna kill a tree doing that. But every week, every month, there's something in the news about trafficking. This one is, let's look at the most recent. The most recent was just a few days ago, actually. The fourth defendant was convicted in a Mexican sex trafficking ring here in Atlanta. The victims are coming from Mexico. It was happening here. Last October, 70 people were arrested. 82 minors were rescued. The year before that, 149 underage victims were rescued. The youngest was 12 years old. And it's not just little girls. We've got transgender children. We've got males. We've got females. This impacts everyone. And if we take our circle out far enough, you will know someone who knows someone who is impacted by this. So take the step, take the initiative. It's an uncomfortable topic for a lot of people to talk about, but it's real. And here in Atlanta, we're dealing with it especially. We were number one, we're now down to, I heard three, and then I heard four and five, but we're in the top five in our country. And that's an issue for us. So if we all take the initiative to take one of these and follow the same method that we were gonna do with the Universal Declaration, take one, man, fold it up and stick it in a drawer when you go to a hotel or lay it out somewhere. Share this information and get the word out there, and don't be afraid to talk about it, because this is our reality. And the victims of this stuff, they're not just homeless kids or drug addicts. You've got the girls from the suburbs who are befriended, oh baby, I love you, I love you, I love you, come, let me help you, let me buy you this, let me buy you that. And they get them into their fold, and then they sell them into sex slavery or to whatever other kind of human trafficking. So know that it's real, it's happening here, it can happen to us, and we all have the ability to make a difference when it comes to sharing the message. So I'm gonna turn it back over to the universal group, to the environmental group. What's up?
Yeah, so the environmental group took a different route from them. We kind of divide ourselves based on our passions and what we cared about, and because of that, we decided to get together, and as you saw in the amazing documentary, we truly did, just as organically as you saw, come about the idea, slightly less awkwardly than shown, but nonetheless, just as organic. We brainstormed, talked about what we could do, what would be feasible, what would be impactful, and what would outlive our short stint in this 8-week class. And based upon those metrics, we decided that our best course of action would be a ebook of sort. And through that, we would tackle multiple things dedicated towards college freshmen and seeing as they're in a malleable state early on, independent, we could hopefully impact them in a great way. And so we got that deal, we ran with it, and we decided to make an ebook, and we divided up 5 chapters. Different people were doing different things. Me and a buddy were looking at restaurants and different businesses. Some people were looking at nonprofits. Some people were looking at fast facts. And through all of that, we compiled this great ebook, as you can see. We also printed it out if anyone wants to see it. We opted not to print it, seeing as that would inadvertently hurt the environment. So we're sticking to digital. And I'm going to let Jalia take it away because she was the architect for most of it.
Yeah, so those of you who are like really involved in campus, we use the database of Canva, which is like kind of like the thing that we use on campus for flyers. I really like the database and the pictures and the clip arts that they had. This picture is given to us from the University of Communications. It's the map of Oglethorpe, and just like put on a globe. And our title is Go You, so just Go You, like OU. And it was created by one of our team members, Justin Brown. Yeah, feature your school. Yeah, thinking globally, acting locally, that was just like our basic mind frame for like this whole project. Yeah, so the pictures correlate with the facts. So there's a picture of a car, the rest of the car. So burning 1 gallon of gasoline puts 19.64 pounds of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. And then also, the world's coral reefs are in the midst of a global mass die-off. As of 2015, coral bleaching has impacted 40% of the world's coral reefs, killing over 4,000 square miles of reefs.
We the logic behind putting fast facts earlier on in the book was kind of shock the readers into action or to realize the implications of our actions, and then kind of give credence to what follows in the book.
We gotta be important to thinking globally, acting locally. So giving people the option to find environmentally conscious nonprofits in the area to go volunteer, because feature points, you gotta get them, and why not? Why not get them somewhere in Atlanta that helps the environment? And some of you guys are actually featured in this picture, so. Let's just continue. So it's familiar, it's Blue Heron, that nature preserve, Earth's Hair, Georgia Conservancy.
Charm is a place to go. You can recycle a lot of things from mattresses to, you know, mini fridges, like if you're leaving.
Yeah, and this was actually my group, and we decided to keep the tips like in a small number, just because like how many people actually look at a book and follow the tips. So we wanted to see like which ones were the most feasible for college students and the most easily available as well.
Some you know, such as reuse rechargeable batteries, bring reusable bags when you shop. I like use cloth towels instead of paper towels. Not exactly intuitive, but when you start doing it, you realize you both said money and help the environment.
This is probably one of my favorite quotes. Can you scroll down a little bit?
Yes.
It says, paper and cardboard come from trees, plastics from oil, metals from rocks, called ores, and glass from sand. Recycling means that we don't have to chop down, extract, or mine to collect more raw materials for making the things we use every day, and less trash that ends up in our ocean. So just by recycling and reusing something, like, you're causing, like, a whole lot of like just like saving money, saving trash, and just like helping a lot of animals too.
Can I just add something to that?
Yeah. So I've been lucky enough to be out on the Sea Shepherd boats. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of Sea Shepherd, but they're the ones that are fighting whaling. And I was stunned to see it's now getting exposed with the oceans of trash that are in our oceans, like these floating islands of garbage. And we don't think about it. When we ask for a straw at a restaurant, we pulled so many turtles out of the ocean and pulled straws out of their faces. So all the little things that we use, we gotta think about, okay, where's that going when it leaves here? Is the trash company really gonna make sure they follow it all the way through? What happens from here to the landfill? So haven't been able to see that myself. That firsthand impact really makes you think a lot about asking for a straw at a restaurant or using plastic when you don't need to.
And the main, idea of the thing being where to buy green local places. You can see some local restaurants, some bakeries, then groceries, the famous Whole Foods. We've got Trader Joe's, Nuts and Berries, not even a half a mile down the street from us. And then you've got Abadabas, you've got Denizen, H&M. And there's various metrics that I use based to find these. Certain restaurants have compost piles that they use, certain ones are certified regarding their electricity and their power usage, and certain things like Whole Foods pride themselves and dedicate themselves to the products that they find, the distributors, the retailers, all of that is with an eco-friendly, conscious point of view.
Yeah, one of my favorites is H&M is one of my favorite stores, and if you bring a bag or even two bags of clothing that you just don't wear, they'll give you 15% off your purchase.
Deciding our services, as the honor code has taught us.
We have plenty of time for questions. If anyone has anything on their mind that they would like to share or ask, then we're all prepared to discuss, debate, or answer.
Yes. Hi. Okay, so did you all think maybe, you know, like putting up the posters, like it was a great idea to like put them in airports and like in BARDA. Like, do you think maybe of going to like homeless shelters? I mean, of course, that's like a given, but like that would be like a great place to start, like shelters for like women and places like that.
Yep. So what I actually did, I didn't go and take them there because there's a certain level of exposure in those kind of locations, but what I did do was I emailed the document to a few different organizations and told them what we were doing and told them what the point of the document was. And from some of them, I got great feedback, and some were like, yeah, well, it'll get ripped down, so we're not gonna bother. Or I had another lady say, well, we have a ladies-only area, I will print it and put it up there. So those kinds of organizations, it's a refugee center, City of Refuge. That's one that was really receptive to it, and they went ahead and put it up for us. One for immigrants put it up for us, and then there were a few others that just didn't bother. But yes, thank you.
A comment. I used to live in the state of Washington, and in all of their rest areas along the highways, they have a placard in every bathroom, both male and female, and in the family bathrooms, giving some of the warning signs of human trafficking and things to look out for. And if you've been, if you think you're being, you've been abducted or you're being trafficked, yes, then please contact this number. And I think that's something their Department of Transportation put on. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure if it's in more places, but I mean, if you're really thinking about trying to get that exposure in more places, maybe doing a little research on how the state of Washington handles this kind of.
Celia, actually, thank you for that, and we certainly will. And Celia had a really, I think, an amazing experience in the airport that I would love for you to share with the group.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
So I was in Tampa, Florida. Oh, Tampa. I forgot Tampa on my list of places, of airports that I put it in. I was in Tampa, Florida for a three-day Krav Maga class. That's like a self-defense seminar, and I was covered in bruises. I mean, it was ugly. And I'm sitting at the airport, my guy's with me, he gets up to go to the restroom, and I have a woman come up to me, and she kind of kneels down and gently says, "Are you okay?" And I smiled, and I said, "I'm great, why do you ask?" And she pointed to my bruises, and she said, "I just wanted to make sure." And in that moment, I was so touched, because here is this woman willing to step out of her comfort zone to ask me if I was okay. Because if I was truly the victim of some degree of abuse or of trafficking or something else that's happening to me, all these people have passed me in the hallway and have not asked anything. But this one woman was willing to take the step to ask that question. And that's what I'm talking about with us getting involved and being willing to step up and step out of our comfort zone and say something and ask something. So that story, I've told it many times because it touched me greatly. But to your point, the city of Atlanta actually and the Atlanta airport also have human trafficking posters. So I should have brought a photo, but as I went around to different airports, if I saw anything related to it, I would photograph it and then send it to the class. But Atlanta especially had these huge billboards. If you go into Terminal A and Terminal D, there are big billboards next to the restrooms where they say, you know, human trafficking is a crime. They do have the phone number. So cities are recognizing it's an issue, and they are putting it out there. But how many times have we walked past a flyer or a billboard and we have no idea what it says, even though we walk past it every day? It's about us being willing to talk about it, to step outside of our comfort zone and tell someone else about it, or ask someone if they're okay, if they appear to not be okay. But one city at a time, and for us, we're working on the mentality of one person at a time. That's why we're here doing this with you and hoping that you're willing to ask questions and give us feedback, and any ideas you have, we're happy to take them, because this is not over for us.
Right. I think it, I wanted to share with you all also, because we have a little bit of extra time, one of the reasons that places like Atlanta are so at risk for human trafficking is because of our professional athletics. Anytime a city has lots of sporting events, or even the Olympics, that city sees a rise in human trafficking and human rights violations. And people from all over the world will come to watch, and they do things that they wouldn't normally do, and they may partake in things they wouldn't normally partake in because they are away from their spouse or they're with some friends, and maybe that pack mentality falls into place. But it's surprising to think that a city that we think is so cultured and diverse and awake could actually be a victim or part of a big problem like that. So I hope that everyone will think about that when you're at your next soccer game or traveling through the airport, and look for those signs, because we do have to ask if our fellow humans are okay sometimes, and that is awkward. But even in places that we wouldn't expect it to be a problem, it is a huge problem. And those human rights violations are being committed daily, everywhere, and it is a major issue. So I don't know if anybody's ever had any experiences where they were curious about something like that, or if they've ever witnessed anything or had any moments where they thought they should ask but they didn't. If anyone's ever had any of those experiences.
Additionally, feel free to ask about the class itself. Mm-hmm. Certainly enticing to take a class that has no finals, tests, syllabus, papers.
Please. Sorry, it's not a question related to the class itself, but for Hasan and Julia. I was wondering if, in your research, I've been hearing a lot about how food waste like really impacts the environment, and it's one of the biggest producers of methane, and it's an easy thing for us to fix. But in your research on like the restaurants and grocery stores that are trying to be more green, did you learn anything about their policies on food waste, how they handle it, what do they do,
Yeah, sir, there's a growing trend in the U.S. It's pretty prevalent in most of Europe now regarding disposal of foods that haven't been used. You see the bakeries a lot where they either take the homeless shelter or they take it somewhere where it can be used or compost of that sort, as opposed to just merely throwing it away. And also, something that came up in our research and that we talked about in our environmental group was just the systemic deficiencies in our culture, where we don't see need to have four different recycling bins or to eat or serve less food than is necessary. I can't remember the statistic, but it's pretty alarming how much food is thrown away in the United States as opposed to European countries that have smaller serving sizes and have far better awareness of that issue.
And to add on that, there is a couple restaurants, the names of them are leaving me right now, but on the West Coast a lot, they were actually in Portland and some places in California. At the end of the day, they'll basically put like to-go containers in a fridge that's like locked up outside of the building, and it literally says like, please help yourself, don't take it all, but like help yourself if you're in need. And I think that's something that's been catching on too. I haven't seen it here yet, but maybe it will.
I think a lot of liability stops that. So I was told we were looking for donations for an organization, right, and they're like, well, we'll get sued if someone at the homeless shelter gets sick eating some of our food. So liability in the, let's say, just society that we live in is preventing a lot of that. In Europe, you don't have such a society that we do. So people are scared to be helpful and to give back. So that's unfortunate, but we've got to change that one person at a time, too.
Blame tort laws.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Please. Were there any classes or organizations here at Oglethorpe that you think helped prepare you for this type of research and this type of class environment?
It was a first for me. Yeah. So I've only been here for a little over a year, and when we walked in and Dr. Collins described what the class was going to be, I said, I'm a very structured kind of person. I'm like, oh, how's that going to work, Dr. Collins? So I don't think anything could have prepared us for it, but Eli did a phenomenal job of guiding us through the research, teaching me Galileo and how everything worked. But I don't have any experience in other classes that
I would just say, but I am a member of ECOS, Environmentally Climate Conscious Oglethorpe Students. So we didn't really go over how much we're hurting the earth. It was just what solution we could take. So I guess in that aspect of like what we can do to stop the problem.
And also I think everybody in the class was pretty much passionate or interested in like the synopsis of what the class was going to be about. So when we all kind of came in, everybody was like, this gives us the opportunity basically to have like a independent study hour, but we were all really interested in the topic. So the whole class seemed to click really well with everything.
I'd go so far to say, as a lot of my other classes kind of failed to prepare me, improperly for the class, because I came in with a kind of slightly pessimistic or realistic, depending on your view of it, I like realistic, view on how team-oriented, especially with students, a class would work in that sense. You see all those jokes about team members letting you down and all those memes, but it wasn't the case. I was very surprised. Everybody was passionate, everybody was driven, everyone wanted to do something or do more than was required. There was no letting each other down. Everyone came in each day as if it was almost their job, and it was a hybrid class, so one day of the week, or usually there would be one day of the week we'd be in class, and the other day we'd be online on Moodle's archaic chat function. And we chatted and talked about what we found, our research, our plans, And after, you know, growing dissatisfaction with the chat function, we made our own Google Hangouts and our Google Pages, and we invited, you know, Dr. Collins so he wouldn't be left in the dark. But, you know, we just kept pursuing efficiencies and getting better and better. And it was, you know, a pleasant reminder that we can, you know, actually do things well as undergrad.
I want to mention that I took an Israeli-Palestinian conflict course with Dr. Sharfman last spring, I believe. And we obviously talked about human rights violations, and that what a deeply complicated issue that is. So there was no resolution at the end of class, but that class did open my eyes to the possibility that I could make a difference somehow. And then I also know that in Core 302, Dr. Sharfman also teaches human rights. So I don't want anyone to leave here thinking that the three students that did know about the Human Rights Declaration, that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights existed, were the only three on campus that do know, because there are classes that come later on or that are offered that do teach human rights and talk about the Declaration of Human Rights and the creation of it. So that does come later. So I just wanted to answer that question about classes.
Yeah, and going off of what Aris said, in terms of content, I'm a communications major, so I feel like a lot of the rhetoric-based classes helped me with that. And also, Dr. Rosenthal currently teaches human rights. It's usually offered in the spring semester, so if there's anything along those lines that appeals to you, I would definitely pursue taking that class, and you can learn more about it. Because I know for me, like, I've always had an interest in human trafficking, or just like wondering, like, what is causing this, why it's an issue. So I was able to explore that in a gender, culture, and communications class, and now I get to pursue that in my new service class.
And PJ was actually the one that led us to be here at last, and she did a lot of the communication for us, so her communications classes contributed to the class in all of those aspects as well, because she knew who to contact for certain things and how to reach out to them. She prepared one of the letters that we sent out to all of the people on the panel there, so having that background was really helpful to us. Dr. Collins?
Yes, in the 4 minutes remaining, I'd like for my colleague here, Eli, to say a few things as well.
Please.
But just 1 minute of comment about what you've heard and what you've seen. So, this is what makes Oglethorpe really great, guys. What you've just experienced. Now, you are all 21st century citizens and students. The 20th century's gone now, and for the most part, it was a mess. So it is your responsibility, this generation, to conquer and solve these global problems. And if we don't, you don't have a choice anymore. If you don't, we will go down to an age of cockroaches. So the present administration or not, do what you need to do. And what you see here is an acronym I call PEP, P-E-P. This was not a lecture class. It's not about memorization, it's not about exams, it's about saving the planet. And what I mean by that is that they had PEP, which is first, as you've seen here, what a beautiful display of passion. That's what real education is about, guys. It's not just memorizing a class and going out and getting a job. It's about finding, as these beautiful students did, finding their passion. And you can find that passion in a class when you really discover what your life purpose is. And you've already heard, they're going to continue this. This is not just about a class assignment, get an A or a B and leave. The other thing is, that acronym is E. They were all engaged, as you heard. Now I know there are other classes here to do this, but I've never seen such engagement before. And I think it's because we're coming to a point in this culture, I really believe this, that we have no choice but to be engaged. You don't have a choice anymore. You have to be engaged. You can't be indifferent. So they were all engaged and dynamically so. I mean, going to airports all over this country, I didn't require that from Celia, right? You did that. And then finally, they produced something. Not another research paper, which I'm sure all of you can do. That's wonderful. There's nothing wrong with that. But they produced something, as you've seen here, that is tangible. that can be taken by students and by people and perhaps spread all over the United States and maybe even the world. When you get a class like that, that's real education. That's doing something. So I'll end with a quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson in a great essay he wrote called The American Scholar. And understand the context. He said, books are for the scholar's idle time. The scholar is meant to act. And so only in your actions are you finally judged. And so I hope none of you go to your grave in the future and think, I could have done something. I could have walked up to that woman in the airport and saved her life. Or I could have done something to not kill a turtle and not ask for a straw in a restaurant. You see, it's, as Carl Sagan said, it's baby steps. One step at a time, and we become the intelligent creatures we were meant to be. Elon?
Well, there's no way I can follow up that.
Oh, yes, you can.
Right? So just, you know, really briefly, my experience with the class, I've worked more closely with this class than I have any other one here at Oglethorpe. You know, hopefully many of you have, you know, been in the library or Tony or I've been in your class to do, you know, research instruction. But, you know, embedding in a class like this, where I was able to help them from the very beginning to the very end, and also see the products that they have here at the end, and can tell that the skills they learned in that class, not just the research, you know, but the teamwork, you know, that they'll be able to apply at other Oglethorpe classes or, you know, in the real world, jobs or graduate schools. You know, to see these students and, you know, all of you, you know, be able to learn these skills in the classroom and then apply them to the real world is why, you know, I work here at Oglethorpe as a librarian. It's why I went to Oglethorpe as an undergraduate. You know, that should be the goal, you know, like Dr. Collins said, of, you know, your education here. I was, you know, honored to be able to participate in this class, you know, so they, you know, just any expectations I had, they just, you know, blew it out of the park. I do have one final question, if that's okay with the panel. What did you learn in this class that you were able to almost immediately apply to your other Oglethorpe classes?
I can hear him first on that one. So I had the unfortunate reality of what I think was a really great idea, and the evolution of that got better and better with brainstorming and working with others. Unfortunately, I either should have delegated the task of raising money to someone else, because that is a shortcoming of mine. I find that to be incredibly uncomfortable. But I think I had a great idea. So I do think that I could have done a better job of asking for help. And I think being struck with reality and a certain amount of disappointment is a great lesson, because it's just gonna keep happening, you know, and you just have to persevere. So you have to learn your lesson and think about how you could have done things differently. And it was an 8-week course, so it's almost as if you have some brilliant ideas and some brainstorming, and then that 8 weeks begins to run out. And if you're not moving quickly enough, and if you're not thinking fast enough, and if you're not asking for help as often as you should, or asking enough people for help, then you can come up short. And I think that was my lesson that I will take with me as I go out and try to save the world one culture at a time. So,
and for me, I'm very anti-group work. I don't trust other students to not just let me do all the work and then they take the credit for it. And in this class, I finally had a positive group experience where I realized, oh, I can rely on my teammates, and oh, people do respond to emails, you know, in the evening when we need to talk about something. So in my classes thereafter, I think I will go in with more trust. Of an open mind. I don't know what goes as far as trust. Trust is taking it a little too far. And trust you with my grade, I don't know. But definitely more open-minded to group work, because the group that I worked with was phenomenal, and I watched the group work in the environmental group, but they were awesome and so cohesive. So that's my long-term takeaway.
Yeah, likewise, as I was going to say, same thing. My faith in group projects has been restored.
Yeah, I think for me, just not letting what I learned in classroom stay in the classroom, just like trying to apply it somewhere else and researching a little bit more.
Great.
Are there any other questions? Any other comments?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.